So for this topic, what all things you have is definition of hazardous waste. That is, what do you mean by hazardous waste? Like nuclear hazards we are saying, so radioactive waste is also hazardous waste. Likewise, there are different characteristics of hazardous waste. Now something that is flammable, okay, that might not be radioactive, but that is hazardous waste. Okay, something that is reactive, say paints, chemicals, okay. That is not radioactive material, okay. That does not impose nuclear hazard, but they come under the category of hazardous waste because they are reactive, okay. So you'll go through the definition of the hazardous waste, the source of the hazardous waste, the characteristics of the hazardous waste, list of hazardous waste, hazardous chemicals, waste control measures, waste treatment methods, and waste disposal methods in very what you say. In very short, we will go through all this. So, what do you mean by a hazardous waste? A hazardous waste is a waste with properties that make it dangerous or capable of having a harmful effect on human health or the environment. Okay, that is hazardous. Correct. So, it is the property that is dangerous or capable of having harmful effect on human health or the environment. And that is why I told you that radioactive nuclear hazard. Nuclear radioactive materials, those are also under the category of hazardous waste. So examples include the drain cleaners, oil, paint, motor oil, antifreeze fuel, poisons, pesticides, herbicides, rodenticides, fluorescent maps, lamp burners, smoke detectors, medical waste, some types of cleaning chemicals, and consumer electronics like television, computers, cell phones, and many, many, many things. These are all considered to be hazardous waste. Now, what are the different sources of hazardous waste? Hazardous waste is generated from many sources, ranging from industrial manufacturing process waste to batteries. Even the small batteries, not just even the big batteries, even the small batteries that we directly dispose of into your municipal solid waste, that is also a type of hazardous waste. And may come in many forms, including liquids, soil, gases, sludges, etc. Okay, so this they can be in solid, liquid, gas, etc. Okay, the perfumes, the deodorants, where it is written that it is flammable. Okay, so those are actually hazardous waste. Okay, and like they have given the examples, like the sources from where this hazardous waste comes: clinical waste, waste oils, water, hydrocarbons or water mixtures, emulsions, waste from the production, formulation, use of resins, latex, plasticizers, glues, adhesives, waste resulting from surface treatment of metals and plastic, residues arising from industrial waste disposal operations, waste which contains certain compounds such as copper, zinc, cadmium, mercury, lead, and asbestos. And household waste residues arising from incineration, that is burning of household waste. Okay, so anything, any of the material in which when we get in contact with them, or any even not just we, even the animals or the plants or anything from the ecosystem gets in contact with those waste, they are affected by those waste. Now, even maybe even because of the fumes, maybe even with direct contact, maybe because of the radiations, it could be any type of direct and indirect contact by which the living organisms might get affected. What are the concerns about hazardous waste? The cause of mass life and material damage and loss, disability, death, fire, explosion. Cause of environmental damages like water, solid, air pollution, under the ground and surface drinking water. Okay, cause of potential increased chemical bioaccumulation that is hard for biodegradability. Bioaccumulation in the sense, for example, when fishes consume a lot of chemical that is mixed in the water, like if the water is polluted with lot of chemicals, okay, and fishes or aquatic life that lives in the that survive in the water. Many chemicals get accumulated in their body. For example, mercury, it gets accumulated in their body, and which degradation, breaking down of that mercury is very difficult. and that is called the bioaccumulation. Some hazardous material, some hazardous chemical getting accumulated in the living organisms. That is called bioaccumulation. Then cause of long-term irreversible health risk, high concerns of transboundary movement of the toxic waste, cause of massive toxic health damages. So these are the concerns of hazardous waste. Then how to classify whether the waste is hazardous or not? How to understand whether a particular waste is hazardous or not? Actually, when you see the segregation made as wet waste and dry waste, and then further you also have a segregation where this dry waste is again segregated into plastic waste, into glass waste, correct, into some metal waste, and into one more category is the hazardous waste. Okay. So you can classify the waste, or you can understand whether this particular waste is hazardous or not from using defined list of criteria as specified by US Environmental Protection Act, identifying components of the waste based on the characteristics of the waste, and reviewing the literature about the inherent characteristics of the waste. So we'll see about it. See, there is a defined list of criteria that is given by US Environmental Protection Act. So according to that category that they have given, criteria, okay, so that from that we can understand whether this waste is hazardous or not and comes under which category. Then what are the different components of the waste? What are the different chemicals within that waste? Okay, from that you can identify, okay, if I know that arsenic, lead, cadmium, these are the toxic materials. So if I know any component or any substance which contains this type of chemicals in it, so immediately I can understand that this is the hazardous waste, right? Then based on the characteristics, based on the performance of the waste, whether it is reactive, whether it is toxic, whether it is flammable, okay. So depending upon the characteristics of the waste, also you can identify whether a waste is hazardous or not. And reviewing the literature about the inherent characteristics. Okay. So, and either by reviewing the literature about the inherent characteristics of the waste, that is a lot of research is being done on this hazardous waste. So, already there are different characteristics. Basically, there are four characteristics defined to understand the hazardous waste. Okay. But then, even a lot of literature is being studied related to what all different characteristics can be shown by this type of the waste. Okay, so reviewing, going through the literature about the hazardous waste, from that also we can make out whether this waste is hazardous or not, correct? Then see, if you talk about this criteria, defined list by US EPA, so listed waste by US Environmental Protection Agency, sorry, Environmental Protection Agency, not Act. So that is, they are categorized into F list, K list, P list and U list. Ab ye F list, K list, P list, U list kya hai? Matlab usme kaun se type of waste aate hai, that we will see. Then characterized waste, that is depending upon the characteristics of the waste, it can be classified like ignitability, corrosivity, reactivity and toxicity. Okay, so that is whether the waste is flammable, corrosive, reactive and toxic. Okay, depending upon how it performs. Okay, so depending upon its characteristics, you can again classify the waste. Then universal waste, that is batteries, pesticides, equipment containing mercury, lamps containing mercury. So that is the components, based on the components. Okay. Mixed waste, that is the radioactive and the hazardous. All radioactive waste are actually hazardous. Electronic waste, like all radioactive waste are hazardous. Similarly, all electronic waste are also the hazardous waste. So all the electrical and the electronic waste, that also comes under the hazardous waste list. Okay. So when you talk about this F list, K list, P list and U list, that is the list wasted by US EPA. So when you talk about the F list, it is the waste on this list that are created from common manufacturing and industrial processes. Because these wastes are produced in multiple industries, they are known as non-specific source waste. Okay, that is, they are created from common manufacturing and industrial processes. Tail is other waste, including the sludge or wastewater from a selection of specific industries, such as petroleum refining or pesticide manufacturing, are included in this list. Since we know the industry they are produced in, they are called as source-specific waste. Okay, so F list are the waste, they are generated from the common manufacturing and industrial processes. They are produced from multiple industry having same type of manufacturing and industrial processes. So they are the non-specific source waste. K list that includes sludge or wastewater coming from specific industries. Okay, so because every industry will have different type of the wastewater generated or the sludge generated will be different for every industry, because that depends, the sludge generated or the wastewater generated depends upon the different processes going on in that particular industry. Correct. The sugar industry wastewater will not be same as related to the petroleum industry. Correct. Because the processes going on is different. Okay. And therefore, from the characteristics of that sludge or the wastewater, immediately we can find out it has come from which particular source. So those are called the source specific waste, which comes under the K list. Then P list and U list, that is the waste on this list, are commercial chemical products being discarded in their unused form. They become hazardous when discarded. So P and U list are the list which are commercial chemical products. Okay, so which are discarded in the unused form. They come under the P list or U list. Maybe the expired products. Okay, so that comes under the P list and the U list. So that is depending upon the US EPA categorization. Okay. Then, like we have seen, that depending upon the characteristics of the waste, hazardous waste, any substance which is explosive, flammable, ignitable, flashpoint, less than 60 degrees Celsius, that it catches fire easily. Okay, so they are under the category of hazardous waste. They can be the solvent washes, the petroleum waste, the waste oil, alcohols, paint waste, cleaning solvents, etc. Then products that are corrosive in nature, like the acid sludges, battery acid waste, caustic wastewater, alkaline cleaning waste, rust remove waste. Okay, so all those chemicals and the products that come under the corrosive, that have the corrosive nature, and therefore they come under the category of the hazardous waste. Then anything that is poisonous, anything that is toxic, anything that is ecotoxic, that is toxic to the living organisms in the ecosystem, anything that is infectious, like the biomedical waste. Okay, so medical waste containing microbial cultures, pathological waste, contaminated human blood, expired medicines. Okay, those, like just I told you here, when you talk about discarded chemical substances, so even the expired medicines can come under it. Okay, so infectious waste, that is products, waste, chemicals or substances which can cause infections. So like the medical waste, those also come under the category of the hazardous waste. Then reactive substances or chemicals that are reactive in nature, like the cyanide plating waste, waste containing strong oxidizers such as chlorine, ozone, peroxide, permanganates, HCl, etc. Then radioactive waste, as I just told you before, that way all the radioactive waste comes under the category of the hazardous waste. So the uranium, the molybdenum, cobalt, iodine, etc., all the types of radioactive waste comes under the category of the hazardous waste. Then bioaccumulate, I mean those waste which have the capability of getting accumulated under the inside the body of the living organisms. Okay. Living organisms could be anything, could be human, could be plant, could be animals, could be anything from the aquatic life. So bioaccumulate, in the sense those waste which have the capacity to get accumulated without getting degraded, without getting broken down, and get accumulated into the bodies of the living organisms. Having so chemicals having, substances having those properties of bioaccumulation, those are also under the characteristics of hazardous waste, like the polychlorinated biphenyl, that is PCB, dioxins, like I told you the example of mercury. So because mercury, bioaccumulation of mercury is most of the time seen in the fishes in the aquatic life. So that also comes under the category of hazardous waste, having the characteristics of bioaccumulation. Okay, so depending upon the characteristics, you can immediately find out, you can immediately identify whether this waste is hazardous waste or not. Then there are various hazardous chemicals like arsenic, lead, benzene, chromium, toluene, cadmium, and many more. So arsenic gets released into the groundwater through agriculture, wood preservatives, glass production. It can cause cancer, respiratory and circulatory problems, many things. You know, arsenic comes under the hazardous waste chemicals itself. Then lead is the hazardous chemical that often occurs near the mining sites. It can get into the food chain and cause various heart diseases. Benzene can be released into the environment because of the gasoline vapors and the automobile exhaust, and has been linked to the leukemia disease. Chromium has been used in the natural gas industry to prevent machinery from rusting. So, but that is also the hazardous chemical. Toluene can enter the environment through its use in solvents and petroleum products. If inhaled at heavy doses, it can damage the central nervous system. Okay. Then cadmium, that is highly toxic in low doses. Cadmium is most found in industrial areas and is released into the environment through fuel combustion, incorrectly handled sewage sludge, and fertilizers. So that is the various hazardous chemicals which are actually every day they are disposed of from the various industries. Then zinc, there are further more hazardous chemicals, because they are, when you talk about hazardous waste, the hazardous chemicals form the major group in the total hazardous waste. Zinc can be released into the atmosphere due to galvanized metal surfaces, motor oil spills, and tire dust, and can accumulate through storm water runoff, that is the rainfall runoff, and harm fish and other aquatic life. Mercury gets into the atmosphere through metal processing, coal burning, medical waste, and more. The health problems it engenders are many, that is the brain damage, kidney and immune system problems, and can result from overexposure to mercury. Pesticides used in industrial scale agriculture, pesticides accumulate through water runoff and find their way into the water supplies. They can cause certain neurological and reproductive disorders. Then the electronic waste, that is when electronics are incorrectly disposed of. Hazardous substances like lead, mercury, arsenic can leak out, because your electronic waste is, even when you talk about batteries, small battery, which is also electronic waste, even that is made of the hazardous chemical like lead, mercury, arsenic. These are the different chemicals that are present in the electronic waste. They can leak out, contaminating their surroundings, such as when they are in the landfill. Over the time, these metals and compounds seep into the soil, and through bioaccumulation are passed along the food chain. Okay, so that get mixed into the soil, mixed into the water, and then it enters into the food chain, causing effects on all the living organisms. Then hazardous waste control measures. So what are the hazardous waste control measures? How can you control the generation of this hazardous waste? Source reduction, technological efficiency, material substitute, good management practice. If you have a technology which is producing certain amount of hazardous waste which is not acceptable, so there are new technologies, advanced technologies coming into the society, which limits the emission of such type of hazardous waste. Material substitute, you can substitute some hazardous waste material with some non-hazardous, non-toxic material, correct? Which cannot produce any toxic gases, any toxic, further any toxic byproducts. Good management practices that can be followed so that the waste that is generated could be reduced. Okay, so that is what could be done at the source. Then waste avoidance, waste minimization, waste recycling, direct reuse or reclamation, waste treatment, and waste disposal. All these things could be done to control the hazardous waste. Okay, or to control, and furthermore, to control its effect of the hazardous waste. If the amount of the hazardous waste is reduced, if the amount reaching the dumping site is reduced, if the amount reaching the treatment is reduced, ultimately the effect of the hazardous waste is going to get reduced, correct? So what are the hazardous waste treatment methods? brine screening, grinding, evaporation. So, like a simple example, like when you talk about even the sludge or the waste or sea, the wastewater coming from the industry, because the industries, every industry, like I told you, will have different type of wastewater. So it will contain certain toxic chemicals, and therefore that also comes under the category of hazardous waste. So certain things, physical methods are drying, screening, grinding, evaporation, sedimentation, filtration, and fixation. Like you talk about sludge, okay, like just we talked that industrial wastewater can even contain sludge. So you can dry that sludge. Okay, screening, if you have the wastewater or some liquid, okay, so screening could be done. Or I would say about the segregation, like when you have the electronic waste, you can segregate and recycle and reuse whatever is important. Grinding could be done, that is, large amount of waste could be shredded into smaller sizes, okay, so that it could be easily disposed of. Evaporation could be done, okay. Sedimentation, so simple methods, liquid waste, any waste which could settle down and could be collected, which can be filtered out. And fixation, like we had seen in the radioactive waste, that certain chemicals or certain substances that should not leak into the atmosphere, they are fixed into some hard substances like concrete or ceramic. Okay, so that is called fixation. Then there are various chemical methods like oxidation, reduction, neutralization, and hydrolysis, which will help in reduction, which are under the category of treatment methods, so that the amount of waste reaching the disposal site is reduced. Okay, so your hazardous materials or hazardous liquid, the hazardous fumes which are generated, they can be treated chemically by oxidation, reduction, neutralization, or hydrolysis process. There are certain chemical methods so that the amount released into the atmosphere is reduced. Then there are certain biological methods like composting. Now, these biological methods will be actually be useful when the hazardous waste contains organic impurities. Okay, in the chemicals which are inorganic, for that biological methods will not be useful. For that, the chemical methods will be useful. But for waste containing the organic impurities like the wastewater, like the sludge, but they are containing organic, but those waste which contain organic impurities, only those things could be treated biologically by composting, aerobic and anaerobic decomposition, activated sludge treatment, enzyme treatment. There are certain biological treatment methods by which the toxic organic impurities in the waste, okay, that could be reduced. So these are the certain biological methods. Then there are thermal methods like incineration, boiling, autoclaving. Okay, the autoclaving and all is the disinfection method, okay, to kill the bacteria. Okay, UV treatment, microwave use. So these are the certain thermal treatment, like incineration is directly the burning of the waste in an enclosed chamber, not open burning. It is burning of the waste in the enclosed chamber, that is called the incineration. Okay. That is also one of the method of treatment, we could say, so that the amount of waste reaching the disposal site will be less. Boiling could be done to remove the certain types of toxic materials or even the bacteria. Autoclaving is done. Autoclaving, just I told you, it is a disinfection technique where, with the help of steam, the bacteria or certain toxic chemicals could be reduced. Then UV treatment could be given and microwave use. So all these are the thermal methods by which the hazardous waste could be treated. Then hazardous waste disposal, treated and not disappeared. Anything that is treated, that doesn't mean that it has got disappeared, it has become zero. Hazardous waste, when it is treated, that is, the toxicity of that waste is reduced, be by chemical method, by a biological method, or any other such method. So toxicity or the hazardous properties are reduced, and then there are ways, then it is supposed to be disposed of. So land farming, that is a treated waste, like I just told you, that your waste is treated by certain methods, and then it is to be disposed of into the disposal sites. So either land farming could be done, that is treated waste can be used as a fertilizer or soil conditioner. Very simple example is this sludge that we were talking. That sludge could be dried, okay, and that sludge could actually be used if it contains organic content, okay. That sludge actually can be used as the fertilizer or soil conditioner. So that is used for land farming. Deep well injection, like in the radioactive waste, we had seen that certain chemicals or certain hazardous chemicals, radioactive chemicals, substances, which should not leak out in the atmosphere, but they are supposed to be disposed of. So they are disposed of by encapsulating them into some hard substances, and then they are disposed under the waterbed or deep waterbed, or deep well injection is done of such type of waste. So very toxic, what do you say, the wastewater which it cannot be treated properly. So deep well injection is done of such materials. Then surface impediment, that is encapsulation, fixation or containment of the waste. Now just what I told you, that fixing of the waste, that it should not leak out, fixing, encapsulating it within some hard material. Okay. This method involves arresting or demobilizing, okay, the movement or migration of the waste by containing it in a hardcore, clay soil, thermoplastic polymers, non-corrosive metallic containers. So these all things could be used in order to accumulate, in order to arrest those hazardous materials. Okay. Then ocean dumping is also most of the times followed, because ocean, if the hazardous waste is not that toxic, ocean dumping, deep ocean dumping is also done. And it is assumed that the since ocean, which contains so much quantity of the water, it can dilute the waste water, that is, or the waste coming to its source. So even ocean dumping is followed, but these all things to be done only after treating your waste and not disposing your untreated waste. Okay, so that was about the hazardous waste. Some things that are there in your syllabus, so that I have covered in this hazardous waste topic. Very simple things are there in your syllabus. Okay, I'll just show you a video related to it.
What is a hazardous material and hazardous waste? Hazardous materials are unused products, while hazardous waste is any solid, liquid, or contained gaseous matter that you no longer use or either recycle, throw away, or store until you have enough to treat or dispose of. Hazardous materials and hazardous waste have the potential to cause harm to humans, animals, or the environment. When does a hazardous waste become regulated? There are two ways a waste may be brought into the hazardous waste regulatory system: listing and identification through characteristics. Listed waste. Your waste is considered hazardous if it appears on any one of the four lists of hazardous waste contained in RCRA Regulations 40 CFR 261. Characteristic waste. Even if a waste does not appear on one of the EPA lists, it is considered hazardous if it has one or more of the following characteristics: ignitable, corrosive, reactivity, or toxicity. Let's take a look at each of the characteristics in detail. Ignitable. Wastes that are hazardous due to ignitability characteristic include liquids with a flash point below 140 degrees Fahrenheit. Non-liquids that cause fire through specific conditions, are spontaneously combustible, ignitable compressed gases, and oxidizers. EPA has assigned D001 as the waste code for ignitable hazardous waste. Corrosive. Wastes that are hazardous due to corrosivity characteristics include aqueous waste with a pH of less than 2 and a pH greater than or equal to 12.5 or based on the liquid's ability to corrode steel. EPA assigned D002 as the waste code for this type of waste. Reactivity. Wastes that are hazardous due to reactivity characteristic may be unstable under normal conditions, may react with water, may give off toxic gases, and may be capable of detonation or explosion under normal conditions or when heated. EPA has signed D003 as the waste code for reactive hazardous waste. Toxicity. Wastes that are hazardous due to toxicity characteristic are harmful when ingested or absorbed. Toxic wastes present a concern as they may be able to leach from waste and pollute groundwater. The toxicity of waste is determined by the Toxicity Characteristic Leaching Procedure, TCLP. EPA has signed waste codes D004 through D043 that correspond to contaminant and its associated TCLP concentration. A generator may generate other hazardous waste beyond the examples mentioned. It is their responsibility to determine whether their waste is hazardous.
This is a This is a landfill. The world generates over 1 billion tons of garbage each year. That's over 3 million tons of garbage in a single day. But a large majority of it doesn't even make it to a landfill because it's chemically unstable. 400 million tons of our yearly waste is considered hazardous and is frequently burned up. The US released 880,000 tons of CO2 emissions in 2016 alone. In fact, a lot of the hazardous products that get sent to the incinerator, like aerosol cans, paint, and bleach, have barely been used. If a product is dented or sticky, often a retailer can't or won't sell them. They just get thrown away. And the disposal of these products can have a pretty disastrous effect on the environment. So, what are we doing to prevent this needless pollution? Among household items, substances are considered hazardous if they're toxic, corrosive, reactive, or flammable. So, pretty much anything you keep under the kitchen sink. When a retailer or a municipality needs to dispose of these materials, strict guidelines imposed by the EPA state that they can't just be thrown away in a landfill. One reason for this is because landfills are outside and susceptible to weather. Rain, snow, or other precipitation can seep in, mix with, or dissolve hazardous waste and become contaminated. This contaminated water, called leachate, continues to seep into the earth, eventually making it into the water cycle. In an effort to prevent this, we send hazardous waste to an incinerator. But that really isn't a great option either. Though incinerators are equipped with pollution control devices, pollutants from hazardous waste can be difficult to remove. Molecules can still enter the air and form new, more harmful substances, and like leachate from landfills, find their way into the water cycle. But what if we could prevent these materials from becoming waste in the first place? That's where the folks at Smarter Sorting come in.
Smarter Sorting's machine learning technology is creating the first smart chemical database that will empower chemical conservation around the world.
That's Chris Ripley, CEO and founder of Smarter Sorting. But what is it and how does it work?
What Smarter Sorting does is it takes two high-resolution pictures of an item, it weighs it, takes its barcode, and it assembles a complete data record of everything that's in the chemical.
Which is pretty cool when you consider how broad the spectrum of hazardous materials really is. Remember those barely used, dented, or sticky containers? With this new information, disposal facilities and retailers can identify reusable products and divert them away from the incinerator. perfectly good items that are still usable are sent to restore centers for secondhand purchase.
Our vision is to do better things with orphan items. We're going to help retailers and municipalities put these items to use for the purpose in which they were intended.
And we're already seeing the results. Tens of thousands of pounds of materials have been saved from incinerators thanks to smarter sorting. That's great news, but as of now, the world is still on pace to almost double its waste production by the year 2025. That means we'll need to sort a lot more waste. And it starts with the products we bring home. So on your next grocery run, pick out the dented or sticky containers to put under your sink so they don't just get thrown away. After all, the best way to prevent needless waste is to never let it become waste in the first place.